So as you all know, today we are going to start a new topic, and that topic's name is permutations and combinations. Permutations and combinations. Okay. A very important topic, not only for JEE exams, but also if you are a KVPY aspirant, right? Because this particular chapter is based on counting skills, and it is considered to be a part of your mathematical aptitude. Okay, so it basically tests your skills of counting, and therefore this is a very hot topic if you are a KVPY aspirant, or if you are a JEE advanced aspirant, or if you are an Olympiad aspirant. Yes, so PRMO, RMO people, this topic is very much asked. Now, as I told you, this topic is based on your skills. That's why it comes directly from God's book. Okay, because some of you may be blessed with that art. Some of you may not be. Okay. In my teaching span of almost 12 years, I have seen some people can count like this, right? Lightning fast. And some people, like, they're wondering how is this like this? How is this like that? Okay. So there would be instances where you will feel that things are not clicking that fast as compared to what it is clicking to your friends. Okay. Don't get disheartened. You can always, win over it through a lot of practice. This topic is useful not only in the topic itself, but also in chapters like binomial theorem, right? So we'll be doing binomial theorem also in some days, in some weeks. And it will also be useful in probability, right? Probability is what? Probability is, probability of an event is what? Number of favorable events divided by the sample space, right? So when you count those favorable events and when you count those sample space, you basically need that counting skills. And who will provide that skills? This chapter. Okay. So three chapters are directly linked to this. So I would request you all to be very, very attentive and understand the nuances of this. Okay. So let us start. How big is this chapter? I think three classes minimum. Minimum three classes. If I go to a very great depth, probably take four classes, but I would try to wrap this up in three classes. Okay. Useful for statistical analysis? Not really. Not really. No, I don't think so. Okay. Yes. If you say probability distribution functions, yes, PNC would be useful there. And probability distribution function is, yes, remotely linked to statistical analysis. So you may say, yes, there may be an indirect connection, but not directly, Okay. So before I start this chapter, a quick introduction about these two words. What do these two words mean? Of course, combination is something which you keep on hearing. Permutation means arrangement. Permutation means arrangements. Okay. When you hear of the word arrangement, basically arrangement is a two-step procedure. One where you do selection, and whatever you have done as a selection, you order them. Okay. So arrangement is basically selection multiplied with ordering. Okay. So you do a selection and then you order those selected objects. That is called arrangement. To give you an example, let's say, how many arrangement of two alphabets you can do from these three alphabets? So you'll say AB, and then you can arrange AB as BA also. Correct? AC, CA. Correct? BC, CB. BC, CB. Okay. So six arrangements are possible. You can say six arrangements are possible of two alphabets from these three alphabets. Okay. So there is a selection. Basically, you selected two at a time, because my question was, in how many ways can you arrange two objects or two alphabets chosen from ABC? So you selected those two alphabets, and whatever you selected, you ordered them, right? So that would be studied primarily under permutation. What is combination? Combination is just selection. Okay, so as you know, the first step of arrangement is selection. So if you stop there, that means you select and stop, do nothing after that. That means there is no reference to ordering. Then basically that is called combinations, right? So example here, I would say, if you want to select, or if you want to do a combination of two objects or two alphabets from ABC, you will do as AB. Now AB, BA are considered to be same selections. Okay. So there's no point changing their order. AB, AC and BC. So only three combinations will come up from it. Okay. Now many people ask me, sir, arrangement is selection and ordering. So we should study selection before we study ordering, arrangement, right? So the chapter's name should have been combination and permutation. Why we call it as permutation and combination? You'll come to know in some time that permutation is very closely linked to what we call as the fundamental principle of counting. Okay. So you'll be studying two fundamental principles of counting today. And permutation is directly associated to them. That is why we say permutation is more close to actual, you can say, instincts of counting as compared to combinations. That's why we study permutations first and then we study combinations rather than the other way around. Okay. So I hope the difference between the word permutation and combination is clear with this simple example. Another example that I would give is, let us say I want to choose, let's say you are around 27 of you. So let's say I want to choose a team of 5 players to represent Centum Academy for a basketball tournament. Does it really happen? No, I'm just kidding. There's no basketball tournament organized by Centum Academy. So let's say if I want to choose a team of 5 to represent Centum Academy for a basketball tournament, then in basketball tournament, you don't need an ordering of the players. You just choose those 5 players and that's it. Your job is done. Job is over. But let's say if I want to choose a team of 11 to represent Centum Academy for a cricket tournament, then not only I have to choose those 11 players, but I have to also give them some batting order, right? That would be studied under permutations. So basketball team, you can say, will be studied under combinations. But if I want to select a cricket team, I would have to do no permutations. I have to do arrangements also. Sure. How many of you are basketball players? I mean, basketball players, not like self-proclaimed basketball players. Oh, I am basketball player. It's like, have you played to a school level or district level or let's say state level or something like that? Very good. Very good. Nice. Good to see all talented people in my class. Nice. Good. You should always keep a physical activity open. You never know. Right? Okay. So before we start this chapter, I'm going to introduce you to a very important tool, which is called factorial. Naam to sunai hoga. Correct? Okay. Factorials. I'm sure you would have heard of the name factorial several times. Past also, we have discussed several things related to factorial. Okay, just a second. Yeah, I'm sorry, somebody was at the door. Yeah. So factorial, let us understand factorial first and how it can be used and what are the properties of factorial. So factorial of a number n is written as n followed by an exclamation mark and n must be a whole number. So we are calculating factorials or we can calculate factorials only for whole numbers. How is it defined? Factorial is defined as a continued product from n all the way till you reach 1. So n minus 1 n minus 2, this continued product all the way till 1 is called n factorial. Now why it is important to learn this concept? For several reasons. It is directly associated with counting and it will be a very good tool to have if you want to do larger calculations. Okay. The physical significance of factorial is, let me write it down. N factorial basically denotes the number of ways to arrange n distinct objects. Please mark all the words which I am writing. Number of ways to arrange n distinct objects among themselves or taken all at a time. Okay. So let's say you have 3 objects and you want to shuffle their position or you want to order them, then the number of ways to do that will be 3 factorial. The example here that I cited for you, ABC. Okay. If I ask you in how many ways can you shuffle the alphabets A, B, C among themselves? Or in how many ways can you order A, B, C, choosing all of them at a time? Then you'll say A, B, C, A, C, B, B, A, C, B, C, A, C, A, B, C, B, A. If you count 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, right? So this is actually 3 factorial, okay? As you know, factorial definition is n into n minus 1 till n. So 3 into 2 into 1 will give you a 6, okay? So yes, there are a lot of other uses that we'll be seeing in this entire chapter. Factorial will be used like anything, okay? We'll be using it almost in every problem. So factorial has a very important property. What are the property of factorial? Any factorial, if you see, let's say I take an example. Let's say I take 5 factorial. Okay. Let's say I take 5 factorial. Okay. What is 5 factorial? 5 factorial, by definition, it is 5 into 4 into 3 into 2 into 1. Correct? If you see these terms, you would realize that till here, it is actually a 4 factorial, isn't it? Right? So can I say 5 factorial is just 5 multiplied to the factorial of the number just less than this, that is actually 4. So 4 factorial. Right? I could also observe that I can write it like this. That means I could write it as 5 into 4 into 3 factorial. Right? And I can continue doing it like 5 into 4 into 3 into 2 factorial like that. Correct? So this is a very important property in factorial, which basically helps you to express a higher number factorial in terms of a lower number factorial. So I can always express n factorial in terms of a lower number factorial like this. Right? This is a very important property which actually helps us to find 0 factorial also, because 0 factorial may not fit into this definition. Because if you say somebody start multiplying from 0 all the way down till 1, he will say you have gone crazy. How can you go down from 0 to 1? Okay, because 1 is higher than 0. But thanks to this property that we will be now able to answer what is 0 factorial also. Right? As I told you, I can find factorials for whole numbers, which also includes 0. So if I write n as 1, I can write this as 1 factorial as 1 into 0 factorial. So from here, 0 factorial comes out to be 1 factorial by 1. 1 factorial is just a 1 because you're multiplying all the way from 1 to 1. That means 1 only will be there. Okay. So 0 factorial comes from here. Correct? So factorial, this property is very, very important for us to know. We can extend this. We can extend this to any smaller number factorial that we desire. So we can stop here if you want. We can stop here if you want. And so on. And so on. And so on. Okay. So this is something which you should note down, because we'll be using this in many, many problems going forward. Any question, anybody? I think it is related to some kind of, you know, not very sure why it is called so. But yes, definitely it's a good question to search for why factorials are called factorials. Something, it appears something to be like factors or something, but not very exactly sure why it is called factorials. Probably I can Google it out if you want. Why factorial is called a factorial? Why factorial is called so? Okay, so I got an answer from Stack Exchange. Okay, it is because they say that all the numbers involved are actually factors of n factorial. So that is actually correct. If you see 5 factorial, it will have numbers like 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. Now, all of them are actually factors of 120. Now, I'm not saying restricted to it. There can be more factors also, right? There can be 20 as a factor. There can be 10 as a factor. But yes, these numbers are factors of this. Okay. Good. So that question was good question, Anurag. Yeah. See, I also get to learn along with you. So there are some questions which make me also think, and then I look out for that solution and I also learn. So you, not only I am your teacher, but you are also my teacher in some way. Thank you. Okay, so this is about factorial. Now, a few factorials you must by heart it. Okay, by heart it, by lung it, by kidney it, whatever you call it, because they're very, very important and you won't get a time for you to sit and calculate them. And especially you don't have a calculator. So some things which I want you to remember are the following. 0 factorial, we just now derived, it's 1. 1 factorial is 1, 2 factorial is 2, 3 factorial is 6, 4 factorial is 24, 5 factorial is 120, 6 factorial is 720, 7 factorial is 5040. Beyond that, you would not need it. Okay, so knowing these is good enough for your day-to-day dealing with factorials. Some properties which I would like you to, you know, be cautious against. Okay, a few important points. I've seen in past people misusing these properties. Number one, there is nothing like x plus y factorial is x factorial plus y factorial. Please do not fall into this trap. Okay. 2 plus 3 factorial is not 2 factorial plus 3 factorial. You can check it out. 5 factorial is 120. 2 factorial plus 3 factorial will be 10. Okay. So, sorry, 8. Okay. So, don't fall for this property. Similarly, if somebody says x minus y factorial is x factorial minus y factorial, please do not fall for this. Not correct. Similarly, x into y factorial is x factorial into y factorial. Definitely not correct. So these all properties I'm writing and, you know, scratching it off, because many of you would have a tendency somehow to apply them in problem solving. They are absolutely wrong. Okay, they're absolutely wrong. Please do not use them. Okay, same goes with x factorial by y factorial. If at all they are, the x by y is an integer, so x by y factorial is not x factorial by y factorial. Okay. Has nothing to do it with it. Let's say I take x as 4 and y is 2. 4 by 2 is 2, 2 factorial is 2. But if you do 4 factorial by 2 factorial, it will be 24 by 2, which is 12. They're not equal. So all these properties are bogus. Please be aware of them. Could you go back to the table? Sure, Madhav, I'll do that. Yeah, the small table. Okay, is this fine? Now time to take some questions. Time to take some questions and let's understand these properties, how they work. 2n factorial, I've seen people doing this. 2n factorial, they write it as 2 factorial n factorial. No, it doesn't work like that. Okay, let's start with a question. A very simple question. Can I go to the next page? People who are copying, are you done with it? Okay. Have you done this chapter in school so that I can afford to be a little bit fast? Have you done this chapter in school? Okay. So let's take questions. I'll start with this question. Let's do only question number 3 and 4. Solve for x if it is given that x plus 3 factorial times 2x minus 1 factorial upon 2x plus 1 factorial times x plus 2 factorial is 7 by 72. Solve for x. Okay, in YPR you're doing it. Nice. Okay, Pranav. Then HSR guys should rock today. We should be able to answer all the questions. What about SSRVM and EPS? Done, Adrija? I mean, is it going on or done? Oh, done. Okay. Nice. Okay, third one. What's the answer? Note that when you're solving factorial questions, please do not entertain any such values which will make any of the factorial notation or any of the term within factorial a fraction or a negative integer. Because factorial operation, as I told, is only defined for whole numbers. So any x value that comes out through your operations and it happens to make any one of the expression which is subjected to a factorial as a negative integer or a fraction, those x values will be rejected. Very good, Aditya. So let us do it because it's an easy question. Now, as you can see, x plus 3 factorial and there's an x plus 2 factorial. So what I'll do, I'll write x plus 3 factorial as x plus 3 times x plus 2 factorial, right? It is basically the use of the property where a higher number factorial can be expressed as a lower number factorial, right? Now, I can also see in my expression that there's a 2x plus 1 and there's a 2x minus 1 factorial sitting over here. So I'll write my 2x plus 1 factorial as 2x plus 1 times 2x times 2x minus 1 factorial like this, right? So I can go down and down till I realize that I'm getting x minus 1, 2x minus 1 factorial, right? So this is how I have to go down. I can only go down in steps of 1, right? So now, having done that, a lot of terms would get cancelled. Okay, so I think this term will get cancelled with this. This term will get cancelled with this. I think 2 will get cancelled here with 36. Let's cross multiply. So 36 times x plus 3 is 7 times 2x plus 1. So this gives me 36x plus 108. This is 14x square plus 7x. So this gives me 14x square minus 29x. Minus 108 equal to 0. Oh, quite ugly terms are there. But I think this is factorizable as minus 56 plus 27. Yeah, that will work. So 14x take common. So x minus 4 plus 27 take common. X minus 4 equal to 0. So 14x plus 27 times x minus 4 equal to 0. So this implies x could be 4 or x could be minus 27 by 14. But I'm very sure this is rejected because it will make the terms in the factorial as fractions. Okay. So the only value accepted is plus 4. So your answer is x is equal to 4. Well done, Aditya. Well done, Advik. Very good. Without much waste of time, can we attempt our fourth one also? Those who have done this chapter, you would be familiar with this expression. What is this expression, by the way? And this expression? Those who have done this chapter in school. Yeah, this is XC2. This is XC4. Correct. Okay. So the question is X factorial. The question is X factorial is 2. Sorry, X factorial by 2 factorial X minus 2 factorial is 2. X factorial by 4 factorial x minus 4 factorial is 2 is to 1. Find x. Is 2 means you have to divide something like this. Yeah. Very good, Pranav. Nice. Okay, Advik. As you have done this in school, so I'm expecting you to be fast. Yeah. Okay. Very good. So x factorial gone. 2 factorial and 24 will go by a factor of 12. Correct? And not only that, let me bring the 12 on the other side. So simplifying gives me this. 2 by 12 will be 1 by 6. Now remember, x minus 2 is a larger number as compared to x minus 4. Yes. So let me express x minus 2 in terms of x minus 4 factorial. So what I'll do is I'll write x minus 2 factorial as x minus 2, x minus 3, x minus 4 factorial. And these two terms will go for a toss, which implies x minus 2, x minus 3 is equal to 6. Now, one way to solve this is, of course, you can open it up and get a quadratic out of it. Another way would be, in fact, that is a smarter way, and that would be very helpful when we deal with, let's say, a cubic or a biquadratic or a pentic kind of polynomial over here. If you see here very closely, you would realize that these are product of two consecutive positive numbers. Correct? So they are positive numbers for sure. Why positive numbers? Why? Because they were subjected to factorial, right? Right? So x minus 2 has to be a positive, you can say a whole number, positive whole number. This is also a whole number. And two product of consecutive whole numbers is giving you 6. That means it is basically only possible when you are equating this to a 3 and this with a 2. Correct? So if you compare this with a 3, or if you compare this with a 2, right, from both of them, your answer would be the same, which is 5. That's another way to solve it. In this case, of course, it's too easy for you to expand it and do it as well. But let's say if it was a cubic or a biquadratic where factorization, or you can say getting the roots, is not that easy, then this method could also prove in very handy. Is this fine? Any questions? All right. Let's take another one. Question is, prove that 2n factorial can be written as 1 into 3 into 5 all the way till 2n minus 1 times 2 to the power n into n factorial. Prove that 2n factorial can be written as 1 into 3 into 5 all the way till 2n minus 1 times 2 to the power n into n factorial. Let's do this. I'll give you 1 minute. I'm sure you would have seen this question in your regular textbooks. Just type done if you're done. Okay, no need to give the explanation. Sorry, Madhav, I missed your message. Could you repeat the method again quickly? Okay, so method there was, if you know that your terms are consecutive, you can break the right side term also as consecutive terms product. That is what I was trying to talk about. Okay, never mind. We'll get more examples in future also when you are solving questions. Done. This example is basically to tell you guys that 2n factorial is not 2 factorial n factorial. Okay. Right. As you can see, it's a much complicated expression than anybody would wrongly take it to be. Okay. So how do you do it? So very simple. 2n factorial, we can write it as 1 into 2 into 3 into 4 into 5 all the way, let's say 2n minus 2, 2n minus 1 till 2n. Okay. I'm not writing all the terms. Basically, I'm just writing the initial few and the last few. Now what I'm going to do is I'm going to take the odd ones together. I'm going to take the odd ones together under one umbrella. I'm sorry. Okay. And I'm going to take the even ones under one umbrella. So 6 and then dot, 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 this, and of course this. Okay. So 2, 4, 6, 8, dot, 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 till 2n minus 2 into 2n. So what I did was I first wrote down them as a continued product from 1 all the way till 2n. That's how factorial is defined. And then I took the odd ones under one umbrella. I've written them in white. And I'm taking the even ones under one umbrella. I've written them in yellow. Okay. The white ones I'm not going to disturb. Let them be as they are. Okay. While the yellow ones, what I'm going to do, from each one of these terms, I'm going to pull out a 2, right? Each one of them can contribute to a factor of 2. So if I pull out a 2 from here, 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 how many 2s, or how many multiples of 2s, or how many times 2s will come out? It'll come out as n times, right? So it'll become 2 into 2 into 2 into 2 n times, so 2 to the power n. While when I do that, it will leave me with a 1 over here. See, if 2 loses a factor of 2, it will be left with a 1. 4 loses a factor of 2, it will be left with a 2. 6 loses a factor of 2, it will be 3. Like this, it will continue all the way till I reach here. Okay? And this term here is clearly n factorial. This term is clearly n factorial. And this is what I wanted to prove. So let us conclude it. Okay. Easy. Most of you got it. Well done. Next question is, could you explain again? Sure, Vaibhav. See, Vaibhav, what I did first was, I wrote 2n factorial as the product from 1 till 2n. Correct? As you can see, I have not written all the terms because, of course, it will be too lengthy for me to write all the terms. Now, what I did was, all the odd ones, I multiplied them together. 1, 3, 5, 7, 9, 11, 13, till 2n minus 1. Okay, I multiplied them together. And all the even ones, which I'm showing with a yellow arc over here. So 2, 4, 6, 8, 10, all the way till 2n, I multiplied them together. So with the odd ones, I did not do anything. I did not disturb them. With the even ones, I started pulling out a factor of 2 from each of the term. So I pulled out a 2 from here, 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 2 from here. So like that, I would collect 2 n times. So 2 into 2 into 2 n times will come. That will be 2 to the power n. Meanwhile, the terms which have lost the 2 will become from 2 to 1. 4 will become from 2 to 2. 6 will become a 3. 8 will become a 4. 2n minus 2 will become an n minus 1. 2n will become an n. Now, 1 till n product is known to be n factorial. So I replace it with n factorial. Done. This is what I wanted to prove. Clear, Vaibhav? Clear? Okay. Now my question is, if 1 plus summation r into r factorial r from 1 to 50 is k factorial, find k. Okay, question is clear. 1 plus summation r into r factorial. This term is separate, by the way. Let me put a bracket around it. R into r factorial, r from 1 to 50. So you're putting first as r1, then rs2, then rs3, and all the way till 50, and you're summing that term. Okay, this entire sum, along with the 1 added over here, gives you k factorial. What is k? Remember, summation is only applied to this term. Okay, this is the term which is undergoing summation. Okay. Basically, I'm asking you, what is 1 plus 1 into 1 factorial, 2 into 2 factorial, 3 into 3 factorial, not 3.3. Okay, don't get it wrong. You cannot find 3.3 and 1.1 factorial. So it is multiplication symbol which I have used. All the way till you reach 50 into 50 factorial. This is some k factorial. What is this k? That is what I am looking out for. Anyone? Correct, Aditya. Very good. Aditya has cracked it. Anybody else? Okay, never mind. Even if you're not able to do it, let us try to look into this term, R into R factorial. Okay. Now, what I will do is I will write this R as R plus 1 minus 1. Okay. And this R factorial, I will keep it as it is. Now, you must be wondering, why am I doing that? It will become very obvious in few seconds. Just wait and watch. Now, if you open the brackets in this way, you would realize that you have actually got R plus 1 factorial minus R factorial. Now, this is a very big achievement for us, which we call in the language of summation as method of difference. Now, officially, I have not done the chapter series sequence progressions with you. But when I do that chapter, you would understand this more deeply, more closely, because this is a type of summation which we normally use. Very close to the heart of the famous mathematician, Srinivasan Ramanujan. So he used this a lot, and sometimes he misused it a lot also. Okay, so when you write it like this, it brings in a lot of advantages. So what is the benefit and what are the advantages that it brings? See, if you start putting your value of R as, let's say, 1, okay, you get 1 into 1 factorial as 2 factorial minus 1 factorial, correct? So put your R as 1 throughout this expression, okay? Then put R as 2. Then you get 2 into 2 factorial equal to 3 factorial minus 2 factorial. Then put R as 3. 3 into 3 factorial is equal to 4 factorial minus 3 factorial. And this continues. Let's say I reach, I'll write 49 first, then I'll write 50. So if I write 49, I get 49 into 49 factorial is equal to 50 factorial minus 49 factorial. And finally, when I write the last term 50, this gives me this. Okay. Now you'll see the actual benefit of breaking it like this. Okay. When you add it, when you, let's say, add all the terms to the left side and the right side of this equal to, on the left side, you'll realize you are actually writing R into R factorial from R equal to 1 till 50. On the left, you will get this expression, which is basically what we require over here. As you can see, we require the same expression over here. Whereas on the right side, you'll see that cancellations will happen. This will get cancelled with this. This will get cancelled with this. Similarly, this term will get cancelled with some term which will come over here. Though I have not written it, it's very obvious. This will get cancelled with this. This will get cancelled with some term over here, like that. Ultimately, all the terms on the right side of the equal to would get cancelled except for two of them, which is this and this. That means on my right hand side, I'll get 51 factorial minus 1 factorial. Right? Minus 1, 1 factorial is actually a 1. And let me bring it to the other side. So if you bring it to the other side, 1 plus summation R into R factorial from 1 to 50 will actually become 51 factorial. So this K value is actually 51. Okay. Not an easy question, especially when you have not done the chapter sequence summation, but I thought this is a very good problem. I should talk about it. Okay. Please make a note of this. The same question will now be converted into some other format when we do permutations. So let the permutation concept come in. I'll give you a similar question there also. Okay, note it down. Any questions, any concerns? So this was the key. This was the key. Fine. Can I move on to the next question? Okay. Yeah, see, Aditya, you will realize when I do the chapter of sequence series progressions, there are certain instances where your regular methods of summation won't work. For example, your sigma method of summation, right? That doesn't work in many of the cases. In those type of cases, we try to apply this method, which is called the method of difference. In fact, in this case, it is a special case of method of difference, which we call as the VN method. VN method. So we'll talk about it. As of now, we don't want to get into too much of details. Okay. We'll talk about it when the chapter comes. We'll see various aspects of VN method. Okay. One related question I would like to ask here. Summation of R factorial from R equal to 0 to 100. If you divide it by 15 and find the fractional part of it, what is the value? This bracket denotes the fractional part. Okay, I think question is understood. If you add the factorials from 0 factorial all the way to 100 factorial, and the sum if you divide by 15, and you find the fractional part of that, what will it be? You got the question, right? So it'll give you some number which has got an integer part and a fraction part. Let's say I'm taking a hypothetical case. Let's say it gives you 50.24. So 0.24 is your answer. Of course, that it will not be as small value as 50.24. It will be a huge value, but I'm only interested in the fractional part. Okay, Pranav. Okay, Aditya. Anybody else? Can you give it in the exact form, Shashwat? Exact form means T by Q form. No use of calculator, please. Let me also take your attendance. Okay, Anurag. Cool. Okay, let's discuss this. Okay, you want to change your answer to that. Okay, very good. Now see, fractional part means the non-integral part. Okay, if you look at this term, 0 factorial, 1 factorial, 2 factorial, 3 factorial, 4 factorial, 5 factorial, and so on. Let's say I go till 100 factorial. Okay. Kaushik, it cannot be a fractional part. Fractional part is always a number between 0 to 1. Your answer is well above 1. Okay. Give me your answer in 0 to 1 form. That means remove any integer that you can get from there. Okay, now see, you are basically trying to get this, correct? That means this number is the fractional part, right, of this guy, correct? In other words, if this number is to be written as I plus F, where F is some fraction, right? Where F is some fraction between 0 to 1, then basically I'm looking for F, right? Now, all of you, please pay attention. 15 is made up of 3 and 5, right? Now, the moment a factorial gives you both 3 and 5 into it, from that factorial onwards, there will not be any kind of fractions appearing. Now, what I'm trying to say here is, if I break it up like this, that means I individually divide every term by 15. Okay, let's say I start dividing every term by 15. Okay. Just few of them I'll show you, and then you'll get an idea about what I'm talking about. Okay. So what I'm trying to say is that the moment a factorial gives you both 3 and 5 in its factors or in its expression, from that factorial onwards, that number would be completely divisible by 15. Now, if you see, this is 1 by 15. This is also 1 by 15. This is 2 by 15. This is 6 by 15. This is 24 by 15. But if you see 5 factorial is 120. 120, basically when you're writing 5 factorial, you will have 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. That means 3 and 5 will be present in your 5 factorial. So they will get cancelled with the denominator. As a result, you'll get an integer from there. Are you getting my point? So a pure integer will come out from there. Are you getting it? Similarly, this guy will give you 7 factorial, which is 720 by 15, which is going to give you a 48. A pure integer will come out. Are you getting my point? So all these terms, till you reach 100 factorial by 15, they will all give you some integer terms. Right? That means these terms will not contribute to any kind of fractions. The only ones which will contribute to fractions would be these first 5 ones. These guys will contribute to fractions. Correct? And if you sum them, you'll see that you have actually got 34 by 15. Okay? And this will give you some integer, let's say I dash. Okay? But remember, 34 by 15, you can still extract 2 from there as an integer. So you can write it as 2 plus 4 by 15. Right? So 2 and I dash will become your integer of that required expression. And 4 by 15 would be your fractional part. This would be your fraction part. Right? So your answer is going to be 4 by 15. Sure, I'll explain it once again. See, you're dividing by 15, right? Here, every term you're dividing by 15. So those terms, which after getting divided by 15, doesn't give you a remainder, will those terms contribute to a fraction part? You'll say, obviously, no, correct? So 5 factorial, including 5 factorial, all the way till 100 factorial, every term has a factor of 15 into it. So if you divide 5 factorial by 15, you'll get an integer. 6 factorial by 15, you'll get an integer. 7 factorial by 15, you'll get an integer. Till 100 factorial by 15, you'll get an integer. So all these terms here will be integers. So they will never contribute to a fractional part. Correct? Isn't it? Now, the first 5 terms, which add up to give you 34 by 15, the fractional part will be hidden in this term. So 34 by 15, I have further broken down as 2 plus 4 by 15. And 2 plus I dash will become another integer. So only 4 by 15 will be left out as a fractional part. Fractional part means that will only contribute to the decimal notations in that expression. So that decimal notation would be 4 by 15. That is what I was trying to explain. Does it make sense? Shares especially, does it make sense? I wrote it just to explain that there is an integer part and there is a fraction part. See, I'm just taking an example. Let's say your answer comes out to be 220.36. Okay, I'm just taking an example. Right? So this can be written as 22234 plus 0.36. What do I need, Vaibhav? We need this guy. This is the fraction part, right? If somebody asks what is the fraction part of this, you'll get this. Correct. So what I did, I separated the integer and I separated the fractions. Now what I'm trying to say is that all these terms will contribute to the integer part. And this guy will contribute partially to the integer part and partially to the fraction part. So here I figured out that 2 was the integer part and 4 by 15 was the fraction part. Got it? Okay. Any questions, please do ask. Okay. All right. Now, one of the very important applications of factorial, and a lot of questions have been framed on this in JE main exam, is finding the exponent of a prime number, let's say p, in factorial of a number. Now, let me first explain the name of the topic. Many people don't understand the name of the topic. What is the meaning of exponent? What is the meaning of exponent? Correct, Anurag. Yeah. What is the meaning of exponent? Exponent means power. Correct. Power of a prime number in n factorial. So if I ask you a simple question, in 5 factorial, what is the exponent of 3? Okay. In 5 factorial, find the exponent of 3. Exponent of 3. That means if I prime factorize 5 factorial, that is 2 to the power something, 3 to the power something, 5 to the power something and whatnot, then what will be the power that will appear on 3? That is what we are learning in this particular concept. That is what we are learning in this particular concept, right? So if you prime factorize 5 factorial, okay, what is the exponent of 3? How will you get it out? Let's try to, you know, solve this question. 5 factorial is 1 into 2 into 3 into 4 into 5. I can see that only this will contribute to a 3. No other term can contribute to a 3. So only one 3 will come out in the prime factorization of 5 factorial. So you will say that exponent of 3 in 5 factorial is 1. Most of you have answered it. Very, very good. By the way, the notation that I would be using for it is E P n factorial. Okay. My camera is coming in between. Sorry for these scratches. Okay. So if I ask what is E 3 5 factorial, your answer will be 1. Okay, this is for your prime number which you're looking for, and this is the factorial of the number in which you are looking for the exponent, and that is 1. Okay. Now, these kind of expressions may not be used without defining it. Especially J doesn't use any, unknown expression. Okay, they will always define it for you. Now, this question was fine. What if there was a very big factorial? Let's say I said 50 factorial and I wanted the exponent of 3 there. How will you find that out? Okay, so let us understand the theory with this example. Let us say I want to find out. Let's take another example. I want to find out the exponent of 3 in 50 factorial. How will you find out? Now, if you write 50 factorial, I'm just writing few of the terms so that you know you are convinced with what I'm writing. let me write a few terms like 18 till let's say 27 54, like that. Okay. Now, if I want to know what is the exponent of 3 in 50 factorial, I would like to find out Which terms here would contribute to 3? In fact, there are some terms which will contribute to multiple number of 3s. Correct? So let us first figure out those terms from where I can extract at least one 3. Which will be those terms? You will say, sir, all those factors of 3 will definitely contribute to a 3. Correct? So 3 will contribute. Correct? So 3 will contribute, 6 will contribute, 9 will contribute, 12 will contribute, 15 will contribute, 18 will contribute, 21 will contribute, 24 will contribute, till your last term 48 will contribute. Correct? So can I say all these terms, 3, 6, 9, 12, 15, 18, 21, 24, 27, blah, 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 till 48, they will definitely contribute 1 3 each. Correct? So tell me, how many factors of 3 is present from 1 to 50? Your answer will be 16, isn't it? Yes or no? Basically, you are actually giving me the GIF of 50 by 3. See, why I wrote it like this? Because I want to formalize things. I want to develop a formula for it, isn't it? So can I say these many 3s will come out from factors of 3 present in 1 to 50 terms. Are you convinced with this? Can I put a tick mark over here? Are you happy with this explanation? Correct? So 1, 1, 1, 1, 3 I can pull out from 3, 6, 9, 12, 15, 18, till 48. Okay. Now, is this all? You say no. Because there are certain terms which will contribute more than 1 3s. For example, 9, 18, correct? Correct? 9, 18, 27. These terms will contribute to more than 1 3s, isn't it? So can I say I can extract 50 by 9 such 3s, these many 3s, from those terms which can contribute at least 2 3s. Okay, so from factors of 9, so they will end up giving me these many more 3s, isn't it? See, 3 can only give you 1 3, 6 can only give you 1 3, but 9 can give you 2 3s. One you already extracted in the first round, right? So think as if they are like plants from where you can pluck out 3s. So one fruit you already plucked from it. One more you can pluck from it. Are you getting my point? Similarly, 18 can also contribute 2 3s. Because when you took a 3 for the first time, it was left with 6. 6 can give one more 3 to you. Are you getting my point? So can I say all those factors of 9 which are left, they are eligible to contribute to one more 3? Correct? But is this the end of our game? You'll say no. There are certain terms which have the power to contribute at least 3 3s, like 27 is such term. 27, if you take a 3 from it, it will be 9. 9 again, you can take a 3 from it, it will be 3. And then again, you can take a 3 from it. So 3 3s it can contribute. So can I say, I can obtain GIF of 50 by 7. This is GIF operation. So the, sorry, 27, not. So I can obtain these many threes from factors of 27. Now, I don't think so you'll be able to extract any more threes. So all you can extract are these numbers of threes. So your final answer here would be the exponent of 3 in 50 factorial would be GIF of 50 by 3, which is basically 16 in number. GIF of 50 by 9, which is 5 in number. GIF of 50 by 27, which is, I think, 1 in number. So this is 16 plus 5 plus 1. So answer is going to be 22 threes you can extract from the number. 45. Have I done a mistake somewhere? I didn't understand 45, Shashwat. Okay. Fine. So if you write 50 factorial, then the exponent of 3 that will come out in the prime factorization of 50 factorial will be 22. That means 50 factorial can give out 22 threes out of it, leaving behind an integer. Integer non-divisible by 3. Okay. Is this understood? Now, this is what we are going to scale it up and make a formula out of it. So let us scale this up. In general, if you are asked what is the exponent of a prime number p in n factorial, the formula goes like this: gif of n by p plus gif of n by p square plus gif of n by p cube will go all the way till gif of n by p to the power s, where s is such a number where p to the power s is slightly less than n, but p to the power s plus 1 will become more than n. Okay. In other words, just think as if you have to go till that term, which doesn't give you a zero. Okay. For example, in the previous question, I would not divide 50 by 3 to the power of 4, because 3 to the power 4 will be 81. 50 by 81, fraction part will be 0. Okay. Till you don't start getting a 0. Okay. This formula is basically known as the Lujon's formula. Lujon's formula. Okay. Written as Legendre, but pronounced as Lujon. Okay. This is known as your Lujon's formula. Is this clear? Okay. Now let us take up some questions on the basis of this. Guys, one small thing I would like to highlight over here. This formula only works when you are finding the exponent of a prime number. Okay. This will not work if you're looking for exponent of a non-prime number. However, we can still find it out through other ways. Let's take this one. Find the exponent of 3 in 100 factorial. The factorial symbol is missing. I'll add it up. Let me add it up. Yeah. Find the exponent of 3 in 100 factorial. Please put your answer on the chat box. Easy question. Very good. So you have to find E300 factorial. So as per the Lujon's formula, it is 100 by 3 GIF, 100 by 3 square GIF, 100 by 3 cube GIF, 100 by 3 to the power 4 GIF. Beyond it, it doesn't make a sense to write because it will give me 0, 0, 0. Okay, after this. So I don't want to write. So 100 by 3 GIF is 33. Now the trick here is most people sit and calculate each one of them. You don't have to do that. Once you have calculated 33, you divide that by 3 and take GIF. So 33 by 3 GIF will be 11. 11 by 3 GIF will be 3. 3 by 3 GIF will be 1. So your answer will be 44 plus 4, which is 48. Is this fine? Any questions, any concerns? Can we move on to the next question? Yeah. Find the exponent of 2 in the continued product from 20 all the way till 11. Find the exponent of 2 in the continued product from 20 all the way till 11. Okay, Pranav. Very good. So this is very easy. All you need to do is write the product of 11, 12, all the way till 20 as 20 factorial by 10 factorial, right? So this is like finding the exponent of 2 in 11 into 12 into 20 factorial is like finding the exponent of 2 in 20 factorial minus exponent of 2 in 10 factorial, isn't it? So you see how many 2s can you extract from 20 factorial? See how many 2s you can extract from 10 factorial? And since they have been divided by the exponent law, the power of 2 will get subtracted. So this will be a GIF of 20 by 2, GIF of 20 by 4, that is 2 square, GIF of 20 by 8, which is 2 cube, GIF of 20 by 16, which is 2 to the power 4. Beyond that, I don't have to go. Minus, this will be GIF of 10 by 2, GIF of 10 by 4, and so on. Okay, not so on, 0. I mean, after that will be 0, so you don't have to write. So this will give me 10 plus 5 plus 2 plus 1. This will give me 5 plus 1, right? So 5 plus 1 will get cancelled off. Sorry, 5 plus 2, my bad. 5 plus 2. Oh, one more term can come. Why did I stop here? Sorry. I was having an impression of different term. Yeah, sorry. So 5 plus 2 plus 1. So I can add it 2. So I think 10 will be left off. So answer is 10. Absolutely correct. So those who answered with 10, very, very nice. Okay. Next is, let's take this question. Find the number of zeros at the end of 60 factorial. Find the number of zeros at the end of 60 factorial. That means if you write 60 factorial as a number, what would be the number of zeros it will end with? What is the number of zeros it will end with? I'm not talking about zeros which are in between the non-zero numbers. What will be the last trail of zeros that it will end with? Okay, Pranav, Aritra, nice. Very good, Aditya. Very good, Pratik. Okay, Madhav. Okay. Now, people who are getting 6, it is because you have misused the formula. Okay. You have done GIF of 60 by 10. You have done GIF of 60 by 10 square and so on. Of course, this will not give you anything. This will give you 0. This is a gross misuse of the formula. What did I tell you? The formula will work. That's why some of you are not listening to me properly. The formula will work only when you are finding the exponent of a prime number in factorial of something. Is 10 a prime number? By no means. Correct? So those who are throwing out the answer of 6, probably you did not hear me out properly. Okay? So of course the idea is correct. That means you want to find out that if you write 60 factorial as, you know, something, okay, what would be the power of 10 that will come out? Okay, this is what you're looking out for, right? Because the number of 10s you can pull out from 60 factorial, that would decide how many zeros it will end with. The idea is clear, but the implementation is wrong. Correct? So how else we can solve it? So how we can solve the exponent of 10 in 60 factorial? Now, you just have to think it out. Not a very difficult concept. First of all, think 10 is made up of which two prime numbers? 10 is made up of 2 and 5. Correct? That means 1, 2 and 1, 5 is required to make 1, 10. Right? So let me take you to some chemistry terms. 1 mole of 2 reacts with 1 mole of 5 to produce 1 mole of 10. Correct? So think as if 2 and 5 are reactants and 10 is a product. Okay? Now why I'm worried about this is because now I will check how many 2s are available to me in 60 factorial. And I will check how many 5s are available to me in 60 factorial. Correct? Let us do that first. Because that can be easily done because 2 and 5 are prime numbers. So I can use my Lujon's formula there very easily. So GIF of 60 by 2, GIF of 60 by 2 square, GIF of 60 by 2 cube, GIF of 60 by 2 to the power 4, GIF of 60 by 2 to the power 5, GIF of 60 by 2 to the power 6, I don't need to do actually because that will give me a 0. Okay. So from here, 0, 0 will come. Okay. So this will give me a 30. This will give me a 15. This will give me a 7. This will give me a 3. This will give me a 1. Okay. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. Yeah. So let us calculate how many zeros, how many 2s will be generated. So this will be 45, 55 plus 1. 56. Is this fine? Okay. Now, let me complete. There is something very interesting that I will speak here. Then E5. If you find E5, you'll end up getting 60 by 5, 60 by 5 square, 60 by 5 cube. Now, here onwards, I'll start getting 0, so I need not write 60 by 5 cube. Okay. So this will give me 12 plus 2, which is 14. Now guys, those who calculated E260, you actually wasted your time. So I purposely wasted it to show you why I wasted my time. It is because if you know 1, 2 and 1, 5 is required to make 1, 10. And I know number of 2s which I can extract will always be more than number of 5s I can extract. Then I know that 5 will always be in a lesser quantity. 5 will be your limiting reagent in this case. Right? Yes or no? So why do I waste my time looking for how many 2s I will get when I know that 1, 2 and 1, 5 is required to make a 10. And the number of 5s will actually dictate how many 10s I can make. So why not I just find what is E5 10, 60 factorial? Why should I go for this? So if you're finding this, you are just wasting your time. Okay. So a smart problem solver, he'll just find E5 of 60 factorial and that is 14. That means the power of 10 that you will get in the expansion of 60 factorial will be 14. That means 60 factorial will end in 14 zeros. Are you getting my point? So this is the first problem where basically we learned how to find exponent of a non-prime number. Okay, indirectly. So this question indirectly helped us to understand that. Okay, so let me take a follow-up on this. I hope this concept is clear. Any explanation, any concerns, please do highlight. Let's take another one. Find exponent of, or let me write it like this, find let's say 12 in 100 factorial. Find E12 in 100 factorial. Yes, yes, yes. The chemistry analogy works very well. Yeah. So first time you are seeing an application of chemistry in maths. Up till now you are seeing application of maths in physics and chemistry. But this is the first time chemistry is helping you to solve a maths problem. Okay, very good. Very good, Pooja, Madhav, Pranav. Okay, Shashwat. Aritra, Aditya, okay. All right, let's look into this. Now, 12 is not a prime number, right? But 12 is made up of 2 square into 3 to the power 1. Okay, very good, Hariharan. Want to change your answer? Madhav? Okay, never mind, change it. No issues. Now, for this, I need to see how many 2s I can extract for 100 factorial and how many 3s I can extract from 100 factorial. Now, read this as if 1 mole of 12 is produced by reacting 2 moles of 2 and 1 mole of 3. So I want to check how many moles of 2 is available to me and how many moles of 3 is available to me. And accordingly, from this stoichiometry ratio, I'll be able to know which one of them is a limiting reagent for me. Correct? So let us find out what is E2 of 100 factorial. So this is GIF of 100 by 2, GIF of 100 by 2 square, GIF of 100 by 2 cube, and so on. I think I will go till 100 by 2 to the power 6, if I'm not mistaken. Okay. So this will give me 50. This will give me 25. Then I'll get 12, then I'll get a 6, then I'll get a 3, and then I'll get a 1. So this is 97 twos. Okay. So I have 97 moles of 2 with me. Correct? Let us figure out what is E300 factorial. So this is going to be 100 by 3, 100 by 3 square, 100 by 3 cube, 100 by 3 to the power 4. That's it. I don't have to go any further because I'll start getting 0 from there on. This will give me 33, 11, 3, and 1. Correct? Which is 44 plus 4, 48. 48. Okay. Now, every 1, 3 reacts with 2 2s to generate 112. Correct? So you have 48 moles of 3 and you have 97 moles of 2. Correct? So can I say these 48 moles of 3 would require 96 moles of 2 to generate 48 12s? So thankfully, E is my limiting reagent over here. But let me tell you, this may not always happen because in this case, the ratio is not 1:1. It is 2:1. Had it been 3:1, then 2 would have become a limiting reagent. Are you getting my point? Let's say I had a number 24. If I asked you the number 24, then it would have been the ratio 3:1. Then you will have to check out whether which is the limiting reagent. Accordingly, decide how many product will be formed. So in this case, 3 is the limiting reagent. Your 3 is the limiting reagent. Limiting reagent. If Gaurav sir sees these notes, he will think that I've started teaching chemistry. So there will be 48 12s produced in this. So let me write it like this. E12 100 factorial will give you 48. Okay. Oh. It happens. These mistakes happen. Fine. So I think we are pretty much done with the concept of factorials. So we are now going to give this factorial concept.